As Barca fans worry about Messi's future at the club, it's important to remember that his arriving in the first place wasn't a given, and it wasn't a simple transaction. Today, we're going all the way back to the Pulga signing and the forgotten figures that helped the Argentine get to and stay with the Blaugrana. Hi, I'm Dan Hilton, and this is a Barcelona Podcast YouTube exclusive. The place to start is the parts of the story we know. We know that an undersized Messi needed growth hormone treatment, and Charlie Rexach signed him on a napkin in December of 2000 up on Montjuïc Hill. And the rest, we say, was history. But it wasn't that easy. Our story actually starts much earlier, involving Diego Maradona and Vic Buckingham. Not enough Culés have heard of Josep Maria Minguella, a man that has been in the background of Barca history for more than 50 years. Minguella was a member of the club since the age of 5, growing up in the Le Court district right in the shadow of the first Camp de Le Court, and later the Camp Nou. While he studied law, he was drafted by Barcelona club secretary Hector Carrera in 1970 to be the translator for newly appointed English manager Vic Buckingham. Buckingham only spent 2 years at Barcelona, but Minguella stuck around under Rinus Michels. When Michels left the club in 1975 after winning the 1974 La Liga title, Minguella also left the club, first to Heracles CF, then becoming an agent. His work as an agent led him to Latin and South America, where he scouted plenty of promising talent. 1978 saw the election of Josep Luis Núñez as Barcelona president, and Minguella was again back in the fold in some capacity. Around this time, Minguella pushed for Barca to sign a teenager from Argentinos Juniors, Diego Maradona. Argentina, at that time run by a military dictatorship, refused to let Maradona leave until after the 1982 World Cup. It's not certain how involved Minguella was in the actual deal that brought the Mercurial Maradona to Catalonia in 1982, but what is certain is his role in planting the seeds. Minguella continued scouting, suggesting, and helping to acquire talent for Barcelona. Guillermo Amor, Romario, Miguel Angel Nadal, Christo Stoichkov are just some of those names. It's hard to believe that Messi would have remained hidden for much longer than he did, but Minguella first caught wind of a 12-year-old boy for Newell's Old Boys that was better than all the rest. Juan Gaspar's board was skeptical of another Argentinian suggestion from Minguella, considering the issues with Maradona and the recent underwhelming signing of Juan Ramon Riquelme. So Minguella paid for Messi and his dad Jorge to fly to Barcelona and put them in a hotel with his own money. This is the point where Charlie Rexach enters stage left. Rexach was a longtime player and regular post-playing figure at the club in a ton of different roles. Rexach was a club advisor at the time, and he was able to get a friendly match to act as a trial for little Lionel. After seeing all he needed to see, Rexach was convinced. Others at the club still were not so convinced and dragged their feet to the point where Jorge Messi was considering either heading back to Argentina and killing the move or listening to another club that was starting to be interested. At the meeting of the Pompeia Tennis Club on Montjuïc Hill is where the napkin was signed, about a month after the Messis had come to Barcelona. The Messis were represented by Horacio Gaglioli, who is also said to be the initial player in alerting Minguella to the player's talent in Argentina. As a technical secretary of the club, Rexach had the power to make the agreement, but still needed some more support. Juan Lacueva, the director general at Barca at the time, proved to be that support. He wasn't happy with other executives for dragging their feet either, and he began to pay for the teenager's growth hormone treatments with his own funds. Lacueva was the one that took over negotiations after the napkin was signed, putting the agreement to real letter-headed paper. It may all sound like bureaucracy, but consider every failed transfer an almost legend. Football is a business, and the boring stuff matters. Some board members still disagree about making him the most expensive 13-year-old ever, so this led to Lacueva paying for the treatments just to keep the deal alive. He admitted that he was later reimbursed, and while paying for the treatments can be seen as a noble act, it also had much to do with the fact that he wasn't officially signed, and the club technically shouldn't have been paying at that stage. These three all saw what we see today, but it always begs the question, even though he was smaller than the rest, why didn't the others see it? Maybe they did, but weren't willing to be patient enough for the result. Football, especially for a club like Barcelona, is all about the next match. Minguella, Rexach, and Lacueva fortunately had the foresight, like Johan Cruyff, to trust in the future talent of youth and the power of La Masia. Alex Garcia, Messi's coach for a very talented cadet A squad, was also a pivotal figure for the Argentine, along with a few other Barca greats, but we'll have more on that in a future video. For more on this story, check out Graham Hunter's The Making of the Greatest Team in the World, You can find that link down in the description. Minguella had a failed run at the presidency. Rexach had a number of failed attempts on the touchline. And Lacueva was only a Barcelona executive from 2000 to 2003, and unfortunately passed away in 2014. But hopefully, these three begin to get the credit they deserve for arguably the most important deal in FC Barcelona history. If you want more histories like this, give us a like and subscribe to the channel. Also, check out our podcast here on YouTube or wherever you get your podcasts. And as always, until next time, stay safe and Forza Barça!